A very good day to all of you. Welcome to the course Probability Theory and Stochastic Processes. I'm Dr. Hima Bindu Valiveti, working as a professor in the Department of ECE of GRIT. So we're going to start with a very basic unit, that is Introduction to Probability. The entire unit one is segregated into 9 different lessons. It starts off with what a sample space is, what is an experiment, and what are the types of events, then runs on to probability definition and the axioms. So on and so forth. You're going to come across your mathematical concepts that you have learned in your grade 10 or so. So we were talking about joint probability, conditional probability, then Bayes' theorem, so on and so forth. And then slowly you will be entering into the distribution and density functions, which we will be knowing down the line, right? To start off with the very first thing, what is probability basically? We use that term many number of times. What is the probability of the traffic being cleared in another 10 minutes time? So on and so forth. We use them in our regular vocabulary or regular talks that we use. So basically, when you talk about mathematical analysis or when you talk about technical aspects of it, it is the study of randomness. It is defined as the study of randomness. Now, what is randomness? What is basically random in nature? If you're wondering what randomness is, then it is exactly the opposite of deterministic. So what is deterministic basically? It is the ability to assess the occurrence of any event. For suppose you are very absolute about the result or the outcome of any particular event, then you say it is deterministic in nature. For example, if I ask you to tell the distance between in how many footsteps can you reach from your house to the nearest shop? So it would be with one experiment, you would be able to know what the outcome is, and it would be more or less absolute, right? But whenever you, if I ask you to toss a coin, for suppose, tossing a coin, and I ask you to tell whether it is a head or tail, you will have that dilemma that comes up to your mind. Whenever you have a dilemma or a question that comes up to your mind, it automatically means that you are trying to know what the probability is by doing an experiment, right? Apart from that, we have our stock market, we have our gold rates, and then we have the elections, which have a lot of probability and which are quite random in nature. The study, and in general, these are the applications where we use probability. They are more, and they are, uncountable. You have many applications where probability is used, right? And why do we communication engineers needing probability at all? Now, whenever you talk about something known as noise, noise is everywhere. When you talk to your friend, there's noise coming up in the background. And in the same way, when you talk about a machine or a communication system, there is some noise that is inherently built inside it. So for you to basically design a reliable communication protocol, for example, I'm talking about cell phones, for you to design a communication protocol or for you to design a perfect communication system, you need to understand what random noise is. And as the name itself implies, it is for us to start. The noise is absolutely random in nature. It is just scribbling. Noise is like if you scribble on a writing pad or on a paper, that can be termed as noise. Whereas if you draw a sine wave with a certain amplitude and a very particular phase, then you call that deterministic in nature. So to study that randomness, we need to understand what probability is in the first place. Apart from this, if you talk about computer science engineers, there are many randomized algorithms that are in place, which are used to solve highly critical problems. So for that also we need probability. These are the very basic examples, real time, or the basic examples that you are given so as to understand the importance of probability, right? So moving on, basically this is the first lesson. We are going to talk about experiments and sample spaces, discrete and continuous sample spaces, and thereafter events. Just to start with, what is a random experiment? Firstly, that is the first question that pops up. And a random experiment is an experiment whose outcome cannot be predicted before the experiment is performed. Quite like a tongue twister, I must say, isn't it? So what is a random experiment? In short, let us just talk about taking with the help of an example. So you toss a coin, which is we have already talked about, and apart from that you have throwing a die. When you throw a die, can you be very certain about what number comes between 1 and 6? It's quite hard to say unless you are the Shakuni of Mahabharata. So I don't think all of us possess those attitudes or those traits to ensure what number is coming up when you throw a die. So these are all random in nature, and basically a random experiment, again to repeat, is an experiment whose outcome cannot be predicted before the experiment is performed. So you have no prediction ability. It is absolutely non-anticipating in nature. So coming to what a sample space is, all of us must have known what sets is, isn't it? Set theory, right? You must have come across many examples of set theory. So sample space, you can relate it as a complete set. Where is a set? Sample space is a set of all possible outcomes of a random experiment. So each outcome over there is known as a sample point. So for example, if you're talking about tossing the same coin twice. So when you toss a coin, what are the two probabilities that we have? Head and tail. So if you're tossing the same coin twice, so you have a probability of either two heads coming up here. If you see the board over here, you have a sample set that is completely created. S is known as a sample space, and zero is indicated by a head and one is indicated by a tail. So when you throw a coin twice, there are four possible outcomes. The first one being both heads, either it is both heads or both tails, or you have one head and one tail, or you have tail and head coming up, right? Why am I, head and tail is different from tail and head. Please understand that if in, you might have, those two are two different events. You might say it's just head or tail the either way, but having a head coming up in the first toss and a tail coming up in the second toss is different from having a tail coming up in the first toss and a head coming up in the second toss. So that is treated as two different outcomes of an event, right? So they are the basic thing that we got to understand is how do we represent a sample set? S is represented in this way. Or if you don't want to take zeros and ones, then you can write it as HH, HT, TH and TT. This is how we talk about or represent a sample set, right? So moving forward, this is one example that I want you to do. You just need to write what the sample space is. I just want you to write down S. Here's the question for you. I'll be sending it over to you in your assignment sheet, but I just want you to take a minute and try this out, right? Now, how do we graphically represent a sample space? Everything needs to be represented graphically for us to have a better understanding. So I'm going forward with the same example. Like if you toss a coin twice, what's going to happen? All of you know the x-axis and the y-axis concept, isn't it? So I'm taking both the outcomes, 0 and 1 on the x-axis and 0 and 1 on the y-axis. So where 0 and 1 over here are outcomes of the first toss, and the one vertically is outcome of the second toss, and the cumulative points, if at all you want to point, it is 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0 and 1, 1. It is, I mean, fair enough, I guess. It is self-explanatory. I won't dig much into this, right? And then moving across there, what are the different classifications? In the initial class, we've seen that they are continuous and discrete sample spaces. So what is a discrete sample space? What is a continuous sample space? That's what we're going to talk about right now. The first one is finite sample space. The name itself implies, many a times, the minute you dig into the name, you would understand what it does. Finite sample space, it has finite number of points. So when something has a finite number of points, it can be continuous and it can be discrete in nature. For example, here when we take tossing a coin, basically. So tossing a coin, it has two outcomes, head or a tail. If you consider head to be 0 and tail to be 1, it is a discrete sample space that is coming up. The second one is countably finite sample space. So the sample space has as many points as the count of the natural numbers. So the natural numbers generally range between 0 and infinity. But if at all you talk about the flight of a bee, I'll explain it with the help of an example. A very huge sample space is basically created. So if I'm just taking the time to be 0 to 5 seconds, and I just want you to draw the flight of a bee, the position where bee is, and for about 5 hours, you can predict the time to be anything. For about 5 hours or 5 days, whatever it is, how much ever you want, you can put it down. So here the sample space is written as all continuous paths. T is given as the time. Time is between 0 and 5. And P cube. Whenever you're talking about the flight of a bee, it is basically you have a 3-point flight. It's like this. It's not just 2 points. You have a third point that comes up over your X, Y, and Z axis. So your bee basically moves around in the 3 axis. So we have represented it as P cube. So P cube is the 3-dimensional position of the bee. So when you talk about this, you start from the 0th minute and then you go about with 0.0001 minute, then 0.0002, or 0.0003, so on and so forth. If you go about it, it is going to create a very, very, very huge sample space, but it is countable in nature, so just like our natural numbers. This is countably finite sample space, right? Which is continuous in nature again. Right now, non-countably infinite sample space. This is the third classification of sample spaces. Now, as the name itself implies, if the sample space has infinite number of elements with continuous values within a given range, for example, you're waiting for a bus, and we know if you have the bus for a 24-hour service, if you miss the 6 o'clock bus, you have another bus at 6:15. If you miss that, you have a bus at 6:30, so on and so forth. If you have a 24-hour service, the number of outcomes that a sample space can have is from 0 to infinity. So this is non-countably infinite sample space where it is conditional in nature. This example in particular, where a bus has 24-hour service, and it runs 365 days a year. So this is the sample set for an example, and these are the classifications of sample space, right? So the last topic for the lesson one is event. So what is an event? We've seen what a sample space is, right? A sample space is where you have an accumulation of all the experiments that are done. We have seen what an experiment is. Experiment is something which you have to perform in nature. Now, what is an event? So, event is termed as one of the outcomes in a given sample space that determines whether the instance or whether the outcome is true or false after the random experiment has been performed. So, whether the event being true or whether the event being false is what we want to know. So, here, to be crisp, event is basically a subset of sample space. So for example, I ask you, what is the chance of you getting ahead in 2 tosses? So there is only one event which basically gives us that, where it is HH, right? We've already seen this. If a coin is tossed twice, the events that are only one head turns up, right? Where, what are the events in which only one head turns up? This is our entire sample space. When you toss a coin twice, you have head, 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 tail, tail, head, and tail, tail. So the question is, if a coin is tossed twice, the events that are only where one head turns up is the second one, head and tail and head. The other two instances are false events. So the event is head, tail, tail, head. That's it. It is a subset of S. Event is a subset of S. Now moving forward, there are various types of events which we can absolutely relate from the set theory. We are going to talk about combining events, and you must have understood seeing the screen what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to talk about M intersection N, M union, and so on and so forth. So we are going to talk completely about set theory. We are going to use the De Morgan's laws to solve a few problems, so on and so forth. So moving on, as you can see on the board, we have consider two events M and N. The intersection of M given N is the event that M and N occurs simultaneously. So when you have two events M and N and they are occurring simultaneously, set M obviously consists of the outcomes for which event M occurs, and set N likewise consists of all outcomes where the event N occurs. So thus the set M given N is set of all outcomes for which both M and N occur. So what is the intersection part over here? You see the junction M intersection N. You can relate, absolutely relate to the set theory, I guess, here. So this is the part M intersection N, and this is one of the combining events, right? Moving on, now when we talk about M union N, it is pretty obvious where M or N, either M or N, if one occurs, then you're going to call that an M union N event, where either M or N or both occur. That is what we are counting in the entire sample space, right? So the next one is we're talking about complement. So what is a complement? Not if you have an event M, the entire events in the sample space which are just not M is calculated as M complement. So if you see in the figure, if you have M, the light blue colored ring is M. So not M is the other part in the sample space. The entire dark blue part is M complement, right? So it can also be given as S minus M, which is absolutely not M or complement of M, right? We have other events, other events where if you have an event M and event S, then the outcome is just event M. S intersection M is M. And if you have both the entire sample space in or the event M alone or both occur at the same time, then the outcome is sample space. So if you're talking about M intersection M complement, obviously both of them cancel out. There's nothing in common at all because it is intersection and it returns a null set, which is data, which is represented as a phi in probability. As I told you, M complement can be written as the entire sample space S minus the event M. So M minus N, it is M intersection N complement. M but not N. So these are the other analogies that we might be required to use in the problem solving procedures. So this is about the lesson one. In lesson two, we are going to see a few problems and a few more axioms of probability. Right? Thank you and have a happy learning.